Hi, my name is Father Simon Lobo. I'm a priest with the Companions of the Cross, and I'm currently serving at Wayne State University. I'm going to be reflecting with you today on our Gospel from Luke from the fourth Sunday of Advent. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke. During those days, Mary set out and traveled to the hill country in haste to a town of Judah, where she entered the house of Zechariah and greeted Elizabeth. When Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the infant leapt in her womb, and Elizabeth, filled with the Holy Spirit, cried out in a loud voice and said, "Most blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb. And how does this happen to me, that the mother of my Lord should come to me? For at the moment the sound of your greeting reached my ears, the infant in my womb leapt for joy. Blessed are you who believed that what was spoken to you by the Lord would be fulfilled." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. So I have to admit, I was tempted to begin this video today with something to the effect of, "If you are watching this right now, you have been left behind." I mean, where the fourth Sunday of Advent just happens to land days after what was predicted to be the end of the Mayan calendar. And there's so much hype leading up to that. And, you know, for all I know, what we're doing today, this recording, maybe nobody will ever listen to it, all these pearls of wisdom that I'm offering you. But getting back to our passage from Luke, we know it to be the second joyful mystery of the Rosary, the Visitation, where Mary goes to visit her cousin Elizabeth. And I presume she's going to assist her during her third trimester of pregnancy. I mean, Elizabeth has never done this before, but then again, neither has Mary. But, you know, so at least Elizabeth has somebody to talk to, because, you know, by that point, Zechariah would have been mute for the last 6 months. But just prior to this, Mary had a visitation of her own from the angel Gabriel, who said, "What say you to the plan of God?" Mary says, "Yes, let it be done to me according to your word, yes." And immediately she's filled with the Holy Spirit. And by the way, this isn't the last time that Mary's going to get filled with the Spirit of God. I mean, she's in the upper room on that day of Pentecost as well. But this first encounter with the Holy Spirit, it's so powerful that as a consequence, the second person of the Trinity is made present in her womb. The Son takes on flesh. She is now pregnant, literally, with God. I mean, the whole thing is awe-inspiring. Anyway, Mary runs off to the hill country to be of help to Elizabeth. And again, just put it into context, Mary is then in her first trimester, which really gives me a deeper appreciation of her generosity. I mean, she's coping with morning sickness during the travels and during her time there. I think all this real human stuff can help us reflect on the story of the Visitation. But it's also important for us to understand a little bit about what's called Old Testament typology, types. There are people or things in the Old Testament which are imperfect, but maybe prophetic versions of what is to be fulfilled in the New Testament. Take, for example, Isaac. We say he's a type of Christ. He's the firstborn. He's to be sacrificed. He literally carries the wood that is to be used for the sacrifice, just as Christ himself is firstborn to be sacrificed, carries the cross. So now whenever I read this passage from Luke chapter 1, I immediately think of 2 Samuel chapter 6, which makes reference to the Ark of the Covenant. So if you recall, centuries earlier, David arose and went to the hill country, that the same region where Elizabeth lives. And just as Elizabeth was awestruck by Mary and said, "How is it that the mother of my Lord should come to me. David, almost word for word, with a holy fear, asks, how is it that the ark of the Lord should come to me? And then later, David leaps for joy, and he dances with abandon before the ark. It says he was wearing a linen apron, you know, basically his undergarments, right? So he's virtually in his birthday suit. But similarly, John the Baptist, unclad, within the womb of Elizabeth, leaps for joy before the presence of Mary. Finally, it's recorded that the Ark of the Covenant stayed there in waiting for 3 months. And likewise, Mary waited with Elizabeth for 3 months. Luke is making it very clear to his readers that there's a connection here. Mary is the Ark of the New Covenant. Just as the Old Testament Ark housed the presence of God, so Mary literally houses the presence of the Son of God. There's lots more symbolism between Mary and the Ark. For example, this precious gold container which held three things: the Ten Commandments, the tablets, the rod of Aaron, representing the priesthood, and the manna, the showbread. Well, Jesus, who is in Mary's womb, represents those same things. He is the new law, he's the great high priest, and he refers to himself as the bread come down from heaven. But anyways, as I was praying about this whole thing, I realized that, and this is the beautiful thing about Scripture, there's so many layers to it, and even for me, even more amazing than all the Old Testament typology is the exchange that takes place between the characters in the visitation. It says, she entered the house of Zechariah and greeted Elizabeth. So by Mary's voice, but when she speaks, she imparts something. John the Baptist is filled with the Holy Spirit. And by the way, this is prophesied earlier by Gabriel to Zechariah in Luke chapter 1, verse 15. He, meaning John the Baptist, will be filled with the Holy Spirit, even from his mother's womb. So John's filled. Next, Elizabeth is filled with the Holy Spirit. Like it's, this thing is contagious, right? It's going from person to person. But it all starts with Mary walking through the door, carrying the presence of Jesus. To prepare us for this year of faith, Pope Benedict XVI wrote a document called the Porta Fidei, the door of faith, which I'm sure you've heard about. But what he's saying is to declare faith in Jesus is like walking through a door. I'm going from one place to another place. And so, I mean, I've been reflecting on different scriptural doors, but one of my favorites is from Revelation chapter 3, verse 20, where Jesus says, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone should hear my voice and opens the door, I will come in to him and eat with him, and he with me." Jesus is like a true gentleman, knocking at the door, waiting to be invited in. And sadly, many of us either ignore his knocking, or we just can't hear it because of all the other noise going on in our life. But what I get from this story of the visitation is that Mary is so keen on transmitting faith to other people that she's willing to walk right through their doorway with Jesus and the Holy Spirit. We find ourselves at the beginning of the fourth week of Advent, which will really only last about 36 hours, because Christmas Eve occurs on Monday night. And I think some of the moms listening to this would understand what it's like to be carrying your firstborn only 36 hours away from your due date. I mean, you'd be probably experiencing contractions, there's excitement, there's anxiety, there's an urgency. And you better believe that Mary has that same urgency. She's willing to do anything, even if it means running up and down hills while nauseous, to bring the gift of faith, Jesus, her son, to your doorstep. With what remains of Advent, echoing what our last few popes have been repeating, swing wide the door to Christ and to his mother, the God-bearer.
Thanks for joining us for another Advent Reflection. My name is Mike Steckschulte. I'm the managing editor of the Michigan Catholic, and I'm here with Father Simon Lobo, who's just given us his reflection for the fourth Sunday of Advent. Father Lobo, thank you for joining us again, and thank you for that inspiring homily. Very, very well given and well put. One thing that stood out especially to me as you were giving your talk was you focused on some of the Old Testament types, mm-hmm. especially as they concern Mary.
Yeah.
And I thought that was very, very insightful. What are some other types that we can see in Mary? And specifically, does this relate at all to Catholics' understanding and the traditional understanding of the Church to how we see the Immaculate Conception?
Mm-hmm. Okay, well, great question. I mean, there are several Old Testament types for Mary. I think in one of the genealogies, I think it's Matthew, he lists five different women in the genealogy. So each one of those women, whether it's Eve, whether it's Rahab, whether it's Bathsheba, you know, Ruth, they all are unique, and they all play a particular role. And so, again, they're an imperfect version of the very unique role that Mary is to play. And Eve particularly, we speak of Mary being the new Eve. So while the Old Testament Eve, she was the mother of all the living, she really messed things up for us, right? Her disobedience is what led to the entrance of sin into the world and death. Whereas by Mary's obedience, as we spoke of at the Annunciation, her yes, she became the mother of all the living who are experiencing new life in Christ. And so there's that Old Testament type of Eve and Mary the new Eve. Another one of my favorites, and this is applicable to how Our Lady is seen as an intercessor, right? We pray to her. We say we pray to God through Mary. What does that mean? Is she an obstacle or something? Well, I think that we see it very clearly in an institution from the ancient Near East, which we call the Queen Mother, right? So if you look at Solomon, for example, who was Solomon's queen? Like he had 700 wives, I think, 300 concubines. They would have been fighting over the throne all the time, right? He was a busy guy, but he only had one mother. So his mother, Bathsheba, was the queen. And again, there's an incident where she walks into the throne room, you know, uninvited. You couldn't do that. And she sits down. There's a particular throne for her specifically, and she leans over, whispers to her son Solomon, saying, "Hey, I'd like to ask this favor of you." Well, what son would deny his mother, right? And so in the same way, we look to Mary. She's the queen mother of the new covenant. So now when we go to her and ask for favors that bring intentions, we're basically saying, please talk to your son, Jesus Christ the King, and give us a positive response, right? So those are a couple of different examples. You mentioned the Immaculate Conception. I often will ask people, well, what was the most sacred thing in the Old Testament? And they think for a while and they say, well, the Ark of the Covenant, right? We know about it through Indiana Jones and everything else. But so then I say, well, what's the most sacred thing in the New Testament? And some people will say, well, the Bible. Like, well, no, like far more sacred than the Bible itself is Jesus, the person of Jesus, right? And so what was the container that held the I'm sorry, what was the Old Testament Ark holding? What was it a container for? And it was for, as I described in my homily, these different things, the tablets, the rod of Aaron, the showbread. But it was made according to a very particular set of instructions from God. It's made of precious gold, and these are the dimensions and everything else. Well, Mary, too, has been made by God in a very particular way. And again, if you go back to 2 Samuel chapter 6, there's this one story in the midst of that where I feel so bad for the guy. His name's Uzzah. The ark is, it's tipping over, and Uzzah just reaches out his hand to stay it from falling, and God said, "Hey, Uzzah, you had no right to touch such a sacred object. You're going to die." And he does, right? Well, how much more sacred and holy and awe-inspiring should be the container that holds not these Old Testament types, but the precious container that holds the Son of God, Mary. And so that's why we believe that for her to hold Jesus, God had to make her pure and clean and holy and save her preemptively through the Immaculate Conception. From the first moment of her existence, she's saved from sin.
I just think that's so awe-inspiring to be a Catholic and to have, especially to have Mary as that advocate for us, that we can go to her and know that Jesus will hear her and just to have her on our side. I think that's so critical. And something else that jumped out at me when you were speaking was your emphasis on the door, mm-hmm. The door that Mary walked through. And it, you know, got me thinking, well, what are some ways that we can open our doors of our lives to Jesus, and how can we how can Mary help us in that?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I think the popes have been saying this often recently. We can have a personal relationship with Jesus. You know, that's beautifully Catholic, meaning Jesus, the Son of God, is a person, is the second person of the Trinity. I am a person, and our persons can be in relationship, right? Well, we can actually have a personal relationship with Mary, too. And I know many Catholics who do, and she's become an avenue for them to encounter Christ. And I think some of the ways we can get to know Mary, first of all, reading the Bible, reading the scriptures that pertain specifically to Mary's life, what she did, her yes, the way that she even suffered. She gives us a great example for that at the cross. So these are different ways in which we can get to know her more. I think the rosary is a beautiful way to open ourselves up. And I'll be honest, I think a lot of people find the rosary can be dry or monotonous. And you know, one thing I would say, if you can't pray it with somebody else or with a small group. I have students of mine who gather, you know, close to midnight every night in the dorms praying the rosary.
And the rosary is a scriptural prayer too. I mean, we see part of it in this week's gospel.
Exactly. So, I mean, maybe open the Bible, read a short passage from that's referring to the mystery that you'll be meditating on. Have an intention when you pray the rosary. I think that always makes it more real. I'm praying for so-and-so who's fighting cancer right now. So it makes the prayer meaningful. Another thing related to Our Lady is make a consecration. The proper way of saying it is consecrate yourself to Jesus through Mary. And again, my students over at Wayne State are just, they're amazing. They, not because of my initiating it, but they've decided that they want to prepare themselves for a Marian consecration. And so right now, again, daily, they're going through Louis de Montfort's 33-day preparation. And it's all it is it's another way of saying, hey, I want to give myself totally, without reservation, to God through Mary. And she's just a way in which we can do that. John Paul II's his motto was totus tuus in Latin for totally yours. I've given myself totally over to you, Mary, because you then bring me totally to Jesus, your Son.
Well, I want to change gears here just for a second and talk a little bit about the year of faith that we're now in. Mm-hmm. As you mentioned, the Holy Father has opened the year of faith on, and he's emphasized, the one point that he's really emphasized is the new evangelization, which is specifically geared toward evangelizing those who are Catholic but who might have fallen away from their faith, might have been poorly catechized. So what is the new evangelization and the year of faith? What does that mean for us Catholics, and how can we help in that effort?
I was just in Rome for... I just love saying that, you know. But did I mention I was just in Rome?
Not every day. People get to say it.
But I was in Rome. I got to be in and around the synod. I was inside the synod hall, but I got to hear a lot of what was going on inside and what was being discussed. So towards the end of October 2012, and I found that the new evangelization is called this new evangelization for the transmission of the Christian faith, right? That's the full title. And that's what I was trying to get at the end of my homily, right? Mary is transmitting faith. And she's the first disciple of Christ. And so she's just an example for us of how to become a disciple. I think that's the goal of evangelization, is how do we make disciples? There's a big difference between a person who goes to church and maybe sits in a pew and puts a few bucks in the collection basket, and a person who's a disciple, somebody who's made a decision, I'm going to follow Jesus, right? And so part of that is, again, this totality. I'm not making Jesus just one component of my life, like one of the many things in orbit around my life, including, you know, soccer and my favorite Italian restaurant and, you know, my girlfriend and my, you know, whatever. No, Jesus is the center. And I think that's our goal, is we ourselves as Catholics need to come to a place where we have made a decision to make Christ the center. But then also we have to be a help to other people around us and try and usher them along and say, hey, being a disciple is great. And here, let me help you. And I think some of the ways we can do that is number one, developing and understanding and trying to share a personal testimony. So simply, what difference does Jesus make for my life? And why is it good? Why Pope Benedict spoke of us being joyful Christians, not these sour Christians. And so why is it? Why is it so good? Why is this really a source of happiness? Why? Another thing could be to become more familiar with what we call the kerygma. So that's the kernel of the gospel, this simple gospel message. Who is Jesus? This person who came, he died for my sins so that I don't have to die. And he's risen and led the way to resurrection. If I would follow him and be connected to this family, the church, then I too can experience resurrection in my life. Like, and just becoming more and more familiar with that, so that we can share it with a person at a moment's notice. And I think lastly, we just have to be praying constantly. Lord, I'm afraid. I'm afraid to evangelize. I don't know how, and I'm saying this for myself, even as a priest, you know, after all these years, I'm still afraid. I'd rather just, you know, not engage, you know, not do anything uncomfortable or whatever. But no, Lord, please give me the courage. Please give me the words. Please give me an opportunity. Maybe today, one person, even if it's just the beginning of a conversation, help me to have a moment to evangelize.
Well, now the Advent season is getting to a close here. In 2 days it's going to be Christmas. 2 days from this fourth Sunday of Advent, and it's the season when our anticipation turns to joy. And I just want to thank you so much for your reflections on this. And I just wondered if you could lead us into the Christmas season with your blessing.
Absolutely. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Lord, I pray your blessings upon Mike and upon all of our viewers here, that that in these last few moments leading up to Christmas, we would be able to just slow things right down. All the busyness, all that has gotten in the way and robbed us of peace, that we would let go of that and find silence and prayer and find you, that we would have a sense of this urgency that the child, the Messiah, is coming. We would ready ourselves and open the door of our hearts for his arrival. So may Almighty God bless you, the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen. Thanks so much.
You're welcome.